Solar energy. The solar energy that reaches the Earth is in the form of electromagnetic waves. These waves can be classified by their wavelength. Notice that the wavelength is the distance from the top of one wave to the top of another. Next, study the electromagnetic spectrum and note which regions of the electromagnetic spectrum have short wavelengths and which regions have longer wavelengths. Wavelengths are measured in micrometers, a millionth of a meter. It takes 1,000 micrometers to make a millimeter, or 1,000,000 micrometers to make a meter. Physical geographers are primarily interested in three bands of the electromagnetic spectrum. Ultraviolet radiation, which ranges from 0.01 micrometers to 0.4 micrometers. Visible light, which ranges from 0.4 micrometers to 0.7 micrometers, and infrared radiation, which has quite a broad range, from 0.7 micrometers all the way up to about 1,000 micrometers, or 1 millimeter. So ultraviolet radiation has the shortest wavelengths of those that we'll be looking at, and infrared here has the longest wavelengths of the types of radiation we'll be studying. Let's look first at ultraviolet radiation. We already briefly discussed UV radiation in Chapter 3 when we learned about ozone depletion. Approximately 8% of the solar radiation that reaches the top of the Earth's atmosphere is ultraviolet light. Ultraviolet radiation has a shorter wavelength than our eyes can see. It's also quite damaging to our skin and our eyes and to other animals and to photosynthetic material of many plants and bacteria. Lucky for us, ozone in the upper stratosphere is very good at absorbing ultraviolet radiation and re-emitting it as infrared heat. This process decreases the amount of ultraviolet radiation that is transmitted to Earth, and it also heats up the upper stratosphere. When humans release ozone-depleting substances into the atmosphere, we are destroying this natural ozone that protects us from ultraviolet radiation. Visible light. Approximately 47% of the radiation that reaches the Earth's atmosphere is visible light. As the name suggests, this is the region of the spectrum that our eyes can sense. Red are the longest wavelengths, then orange, yellow, green, blue, and violet. Shorter wavelengths than violet fall in the ultraviolet range. Longer wavelengths than red fall in the infrared range. Let's look next at infrared, IR. Approximately 45% of the radiation that reaches the Earth's atmosphere is infrared radiation. We often divide infrared further into short infrared, which is infrared emitted by the sun and it's near to the visible spectrum, and long infrared, that's thermal infrared, which is generally emitted by the Earth. We can see those two designations of infrared on figure 4.7, shown here. Notably, all objects emit radiation, but generally hotter objects emit shorter wavelengths than cooler objects. The sun is hot, clearly, and it emits primarily ultraviolet light, visible light, and short infrared, as shown here on figure 4.7. You and the rest of the Earth are cold objects compared to the sun, and we all emit thermal infrared radiation, this longer wave infrared radiation. So this is interesting. The wavelengths emitted by the sun vary considerably from the wavelengths of radiation emitted by the Earth. You can see that shortwave radiation includes short infrared, visible light, and ultraviolet light. In contrast, what we call longwave radiation simply includes a portion of the thermal infrared. For the remainder of the course, when we refer to shortwave radiation, we will be talking about radiation from the sun. Similarly, when we use the term longwave radiation, we will be talking about radiation emitted from the Earth, terrestrial radiation. It's important that you're able to understand and distinguish between these two terms and use them correctly. Shortwave radiation is solar radiation, and longwave radiation is terrestrial radiation. Collectively, we have a name for all the incoming solar radiation that comes from the sun. We call it insolation. Incoming solar radiation. It's essentially an acronym. Please notice that this is not insulation, the stuff you put in the walls of your house. It's insolation with an O, and it stands for incoming solar radiation. Soon we will be looking at maps showing how insolation varies from place to place on Earth. Consider this figure here from your textbook. It shows the average daily insolation, not temperature. Not surprisingly, insolation values are not uniform across the globe. Based on what you know about Earth and Sun relationships, can you tell if this figure shown here represents July or December? Pause the video briefly to figure it out, and be sure you explain why you know it to yourself. What do you think a similar map for July would look like? Or how about if they averaged the values for the entire year? How would a map of average annual values of insolation look different than the December map and different than the July map? All right, moving on. Notably, your book dumps all the Earth's heating and cooling processes into one section and discusses them all together. We're going to separate concepts out a bit to hopefully help you better understand the material. First, we're going to discuss what can happen to solar radiation as it travels through the atmosphere. There's four things that can happen to radiation. A bit later, we're going to look at the three forms of heat transfer. And then lastly, near the end of the lesson, we'll cover a few odds and ends that also have to do with basic warming and cooling processes. Okay, we know the sun emits energy in the form of electromagnetic waves. And these waves are classified by wavelength. Further, we know that shortwave radiation is solar radiation and longwave radiation is terrestrial radiation. So next, let's consider what can happen to solar radiation as it travels through the atmosphere. This is a really important concept, and it's definitely worth taking some quick notes on. It turns out that there's four things that can happen to radiation as it travels through the Earth's atmosphere. Last week, we discussed how some of the ultraviolet radiation is absorbed by ozone molecules in the upper levels of the stratosphere. So, one thing that can happen to radiation is it can be absorbed. Last week, we also mentioned that particulates can block radiation and keep it from reaching the Earth. When particulates are blocking radiation, essentially, one thing that they might be doing is absorbing the radiation. They may also be reflecting it or scattering it. In all cases, it diminishes the amount of radiation that reaches the Earth. Thus, we've already hit on three of the four things that can happen to radiation. Radiation can be absorbed, reflected, scattered, and the final thing that can happen to radiation is it can be transmitted. As I just mentioned, you absolutely need to know these four things that can happen to radiation as it travels through the atmosphere. We're going to spend the next few slides going into more detail on each. First, absorption. Different substances have varying abilities to absorb varying wavelengths. For example, last week we learned that ozone molecules are effective absorbers of UV radiation. This week we will see that water vapor and carbon dioxide are good at absorbing thermal infrared radiation. Notably, nitrogen and oxygen in the atmosphere do not absorb these wavelengths. So again, different substances have varying abilities to absorb varying wavelengths, and you should be able to explain the examples I just gave, and perhaps some others as well. We can also consider substances on the Earth's surface. Some Earth materials are better than others at absorbing visible light. For example, rocks and soil absorb light well, and ice and snow do not. Ice and snow reflect the light. In general, when an object absorbs radiation, its temperature rises. For example, you likely figured out pretty quickly as a kid that black pavement gets hot when it absorbs the visible light from the sun. Interestingly, properties of the material, such as color, can affect absorption. As a child, you figured out that black objects absorb better than white objects. If you're barefoot on a sunny day, do you choose to walk across the blacktop or the cement? Also, if it's really sunny out and you want to stay cool, do you wear black or white? Which car gets hotter in the summer, the black one or the white one? Finally, what color do we often paint the top of school buses in California? It's white, if you didn't know. It's best not to bake the children. White is generally a poor absorber. Instead, it is a good reflector. We can think of reflection as sort of the opposite of absorption. When radiation is reflected, it is bounced in the opposite direction, and its wavelength is not changed. Consider a mirror reflecting light, or visible light and ultraviolet light bouncing back off the snow or water. This is one reason why you can get a nasty sunburn while swimming or while skiing. The ultraviolet light bounces off the snow and water back at you. Objects that are good reflectors are generally poor absorbers, and vice versa. Scattering is like reflection in that the wavelength of the radiation does not change. It differs from reflection, though, because the radiation is not bounced back from where it came. Rather, it's simply deflected in many different directions. There are many gas molecules and particulates in the atmosphere that scatter radiation. Your textbook has a good explanation on how scattering makes the daytime sky look blue, sunsets look red, and cloudy days look gray. I encourage you to review it, and also check out this short and very readable Scientific American article on how pollution can make for redder sunsets. All right, lastly, transmission. If the radiation is not absorbed, reflected, or scattered, what happens to it? Well, it is simply transmitted. That means it passes through the object or the materials or the atmosphere without changing wavelength or direction. We're all pretty familiar with the idea that windows transmit visible light. However, some window glass, depending on the type, does not do a good job of transmitting UV radiation. Thus, we do not get sunburned in our car. Also, window glass does not transmit infrared radiation well. So, infrared radiation, heat, cannot escape. You've likely experienced this on a hot, sunny day, especially if you have a black interior in your car. So why does my car heat up when parked in the sun? Let's use the four concepts we just learned to discuss this. Shortwave radiation, remember that means solar radiation, which is primarily visible light, is transmitted through your car windows. The interior dashboard and upholstery absorb the shortwave radiation, especially if they happen to be black or dark colors, and they re-emit long-wave radiation, which is thermal infrared radiation, heat. The windows are not good at transmitting thermal infrared, so heat builds up in the car, and it gets hot. Notably, some folks put reflective shields inside the car along the windshield to try and reflect some of the shortwave radiation back out through the window. This can help considerably. Also, since white is a better reflector and black is a better absorber, light-colored cars will stay cooler than the dark-colored cars. Of course, another solution is to simply crack open a window to allow the hot air to flow out by convection. We'll talk about convection soon in a future video clip. First, though, go back and review the four things that can happen to radiation, be able to discuss them in the atmosphere, and in terms of how your car heats up. Next, we'll use this knowledge to discuss a very important topic, the greenhouse effect.